trying to find your happiness this winter? Let Fiji Airways fly you there direct. Whether you're sunbathing or snorkeling, dining or dreaming, you'll experience legendary Fijian hospitality. Expect the warmest of welcomes in this Pacific paradise. Unplug, unwind, and relax in your happy place, Fiji. Get great deals on direct flights to happiness at FijiAirways.com. That's FijiAirways.com. You deserve this. Go from here to happiness, flying direct with Fiji Airways.
Why don't more infant formula companies use organic, grass-fed whole milk instead of skim? Why don't more infant formula companies use the latest breast milk science? Why don't more infant formula companies run their own clinical trials? Why don't more infant formula companies use more of the proteins found in breast milk? Why don't more infant formula companies have their own factories instead of outsourcing their manufacturing? We wondered the same thing. So we made ByHeart, an infant formula company on a mission to get a lot closer to the most super superfood on the planet, breast milk. Our patented protein blend has more of the important and most abundant proteins actually found in breast milk. We're the first and only U.S.-made formula to use organic, grass-fed whole milk, not skim. We even conducted the largest clinical trial by a new infant formula company in a quarter century, with clinically proven benefits like easier digestion, less spit-up, and softer poops versus a leading infant formula. And we make our own formula in the USA and our very own factories in Iowa, Oregon, and Pennsylvania. ByHeart, a better formula for formula. Learn more at ByHeart.com.
Welcome, friends, it's the Movie Boom Podcast. Podcast, enjoy the show. Zachy and Brian are talking about the movies. Movie Boom Podcast on the radio.
Welcome to a movie film commentary track. My name is Zaki Hassan, and I'm here with Brian Hall.
I am Brian Hall.
What's it like being Brian Hall?
It's great, you know, living the life of a billionaire playboy, my place up in Malibu, little suitcases filled with rocket packs. It is what it is.
It's an aspirational quality that your life has. women want to be you, men want to be with you.
Yeah.
Did I get that right?
You know what? I am Brian Hall.
It's all good.
It's all good.
It's all good. We are here to talk about Iron Man 2.
Yeah.
If you couldn't tell from that little piece of dinner theater we just did.
Right. Dinner theater.
And scene.
Yeah. You know, I think we did something really special out there, Zach. This is like us behind.
I felt it.
Yeah, during the commercial break. Wow, you know? Really vibing with that.
We're just like, and then, you know, it's like those SNL sketches where it's like the phone call, you just hear the one side, don't do that.
Yeah, is that right? Don't do that.
It's offensive to everybody.
Yeah. Right.
Anyway, so as we are talking through this, we are in the lead up to the release of Marvel Studios' Black Widow.
Yeah, long awaited.
Long awaited. This was supposed to come out originally May of 2020, which is when this commentary track would have come out.
Yeah, and now this is, for his history's sake, this is, what, June 15th, and California is reopening officially,
yeah,
right?
It is. It is the day, as we record this, it is the day that California reopens. But we had always planned to do a commentary track for Iron Man 2 because it is the first appearance of Black Widow. Mm-hmm. And we were going to last year, the plan was it would be for both the 10th anniversary of the film and the first mm-hmm. appearance of Black Widow. It was going to be a twofer. Mm-hmm. But this damned pandemic robbed us.
Damn you, pandemic!
That is the worst thing to happen.
Yeah.
As a result of this pandemic,
they know.
Yeah, but regardless, we're here now. We're doing this.
Yeah,
this is fun. So, I'm not going to spend a lot of time dawdling because we already did our little show at the front. That's all we need to do. So, we are going to watch Iron Man 2, the oft overlooked Iron Man 2.
Yeah.
I'm going to say. So let's take a short break while everybody gets their devices queued up and whatnot. And when we come back, we will watch the movie.
Judy was boring.
Hello.
Then Judy discovered Chumbacasino.com.
It's my little escape.
Now Judy's the life of the party.
Oh, baby, mama's bringing home the bacon.
Whoa, take it easy, Judy. The Chumba life is for everybody. So go to Chumbacasino.com and play over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. Chumbacasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to... Has anyone seen the bride and groom?
Sorry, sorry, we're here. We were getting lucky in the limo and we lost track of time.
No, Lucky Land Casino, with cash prizes that add up quicker than a guest registry.
In that case, I pronounce you lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Daily bonuses are waiting. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details. With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, no, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
And we are back, and we're ready to go. Brian, I'm queued up. You queued up?
I'm queued up.
There is only one cut of Iron Man 2. It is the theatrical 2 hours and 4 minute cut, directed by Jon Favreau, although I'm sure Jon Favreau would say, directed under duress by Jon Favreau.
Right. Yeah.
but we've got lots to say, so I figured let's just start the movie, and then we can talk during it.
All right.
So we'll play on three. One, two, three, play. Here we go. Brian, ready?
Ready.
One, two, three, play. There's the Paramount logo.
Yeah, I was going to say, Zachy, I'm confused. I thought these were Disney movies.
Not when this movie came out.
Right. So this is 2010.
Yeah.
And when did that all go down? That was 2009 was when Disney purchased Marvel, right? For $4 billion, I believe.
Yeah, it was fall of 2009. So after only 2 Marvel Studios movies had come out.
Wow. Wow. I mean, obviously now it's like, well, duh, right? Of a deal.
Yeah.
But that's amazing. With only 2 under their belt, Disney was like, we want on this Marvel train.
Well, and the interesting thing is that, the deal was such that, you know, Marvel Studios, when originally founded, we're talking like 2005, 2006, they had a line of credit and they've signed a deal with Paramount to release the first, I think through Avengers mm-hmm. was like the plan, right? Mm-hmm. So Paramount initially was like, hey, we got this new franchise
right?
In terms of Marvel. And when Disney purchased Marvel, the Paramount deal still had to conclude.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think after this movie came out, they basically worked out a deal where starting with the Avengers, it would just be Disney released.
Right.
So Iron Man 3, Avengers and Iron Man 3 still have the Paramount logo on top of them, but those were Disney releases.
Mm, interesting. Wow.
But Iron Man 2, Thor and Captain America the First Avenger were released after the purchase, but they were still considered Paramount releases.
I remember Disney. Buying the Avengers Blu-ray at the Paramount store on the Paramount.
Oh, see, there you go. Yeah. So Mickey Rourke was originally offered $250,000 for this.
Right.
Which is seems seriously low.
Yeah.
Considering he was coming off an Oscar nomination for The Wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
I think he held him up and they ended up coming back with more money. That being said, I think he gives a $250,000 worth of a performance.
Wait,
I don't know what, wait, I don't know what
elaborate,
he's doing.
Elaborate.
And what I mean is in terms of it being the 250 grand being the lowball amount.
Yeah.
I think he delivers a lowball performance. Cause
okay.
It's not a particularly memorable character, nor is it bolstered by memorable acting on his part. So I don't think Mickey Rourke did much to earn his pay here. That's what I'm saying.
That's very interesting. I have some questions. Okay. So we,
I don't care who I piss off.
Right. So we're watching him right now in what I read, I guess, is one of the few opening credit sequences of any Marvel movie.
That's right.
And yeah. He's hard at this, work here. His father's just passed.
This and the Incredible Hulk, I believe, are the only ones that have like a straight up opening sequence.
Oh, wow. Okay. So a lot of this character's affectations, like the hair, the gold teeth, the cockatoo, apparently that was Rourke's idea. So he was sort of depping it up here, right?
And he ponied up, like the gold teeth and the bird, he paid for himself.
Right.
Which I would call money not well spent.
Right. So wait, so what is this character like in the comics?
Well, the character does not exist in the comics in this way. So his father, so he plays, Mickey Rourke plays Ivan Vanko. Mm-hmm. His father, Anton Vanko, in the comic books was a character called the Crimson Dynamo.
Doesn't Ivan Vanko sound like a villain in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out?
It really does.
Anyway, sorry.
It does. Like, he's Russian. He must be named Ivan. Like, those right, are, that's it. So in the comic books, there is no Ivan Vanko, or at least there wasn't up until, you know, maybe after the movie came out, they sort of tried to catch up. Mm-hmm. But there was Anton Vanko, who was the Crimson Dynamo, who was this Soviet armored character sent over to fight Iron Man, and who Iron Man defeated. And then that character actually ends up defecting.
Okay.
And actually, he works for Tony Stark, he becomes his friend. And the Russians send their agent, the Black Widow, Natasha Romanoff, to retrieve him. So she, you know, in the comic books originally, Natasha was not a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. She was a Russian KGB agent who also ends up defecting.
Now, is that her origin story, or is she Russian for a very long time? And then down the road, they put it through in a twist where then she becomes an ally.
She was a villain initially, and then shortly thereafter became a good guy.
Okay.
And then the idea of her being a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent, I think that came in the 2000s with the Ultimates, the alternate universe Marvel titles, and a lot of that stuff they pulled into the movie universe.
Oh, interesting.
So I've, as we said before, like Nick Fury being a dead ringer for Sam Jackson, that actually originated in the Ultimate comic books, and then the movies followed suit.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I know we've talked about this, but that, you know, Sam Jackson's famously a big comic book fan. So he goes into the comic book shop in like circa 2001, 2002. And he's like, why am I on the cover of this comic book?
Right.
And basically he threatened to hold him up for money. And he essentially was like, fine, I'll let it go. But when you make the movie, you guys better call me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say that ended up working out okay for him in terms of career security. Now, I just want to say right here, there's like a sexiness that we don't see in the Disney era Marvel films.
Yeah. Like right a lot of swooping shots of these sort of cheerleader looking people. And
yep. And even later in the film, you know, when he has his, like, birthday party.
Oh, right. Yeah. Good call. I didn't really
think of that. A little edgier. Now we start here on the Stark Expo with Iron Man flying in. Now, the original version of this movie, they ended up cutting it out, but it would have started with him throwing up he's in his Iron Man suit, and he's on the airplane, and he's barfing into the toilet because he can't hold his liquor.
Right.
And there was kind of more of a runner throughout of his alcoholism.
Right. Which is like a whole storyline in the comics, right?
Yeah. You know, there's a storyline called Demon in a Bottle, which is exactly that. It's Tony Stark being overcome by his substance abuse. And for whatever reason, the movies shied away from it. I would assume part of it is the Disney factor.
Sure.
And I think this movie is about as close as we get to that. And even then, it's not like, hey, you're a drunk, right? They don't go as far as that.
Right. He just has a drunk moment.
Right. But that's very much an iconic, like, you know, it's one of those like, oh, yeah, that's what Iron Man is known for. He had, like, the alcoholism storyline. So it's weird that the movies almost entirely shied away from that.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah, that is funny you mentioned, though, the sexiness. I did notice that, where it's even sort of these shots where it's on Tony, but it's like all these, like, is it like cheerleader mm-hmm. bottoms are yeah, like right. sort of framing the frame on the right and left. And it,
that's right.
It did. I don't know that I actually articulated a thought, but it felt different.
A little different. Yeah. I mean, the, in terms of sexuality and, you know, just the idea of these being human beings who have sexual lives, the Disney era Marvel Studios films don't, like, they're very antiseptic.
Sure. Yeah.
And that's not necessarily a critique, just to be clear, because, like, hey, you know, it's less stuff I got to explain to my kids later.
right.
But definitely, like, in the first film, for example, Stark has the one night stand with Leslie Bibb, right? And it's, again, it's definitely staged in a more mature way, and that's, you don't see that as much later. Mm-hmm. This is the first appearance of John Slattery as Howard Stark. First of many appearances, it turns out.
Right, and very Walt Disney-esque here, right?
Definitely here, yeah.
Yeah, sort of.
And actually, this is the first appearance of Howard Stark in the MCU, because the younger version in Captain America, the first Avenger, would come the following year. Mm.
Wait, so where are we at now in 2010? So we've had Hulk, Iron Man.
Yeah, there was Iron Man was first, okay. and then there was the Incredible Hulk shortly thereafter, mm. and then this.
Oh, that's it. So we didn't have anything in between. Oh, no. Okay.
Kind of crazy, right? Yeah. It's Olivia Munn, by the way, at the time she was host of,
what was that channel?
Yeah, it was, what was that show?
I know exactly what you're talking about. Sort of video gamey, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
She was like part of that first wave of like hot geek chicks that became sort of like a thing, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think she would even describe it that way. And then, you know, she's like in Soderbergh movies and
yeah, I mean, she's like a legit, I mean, she was in a Marvel movie just a couple years later. She was in X-Men Apocalypse.
That's right. Oh, we got the Stan Lee cameo right there.
Stan Lee as Larry King.
Yeah.
We also saw Larry Ellison as Larry Ellison. He's the founder of Oracle.
Right.
And this is Kate Mara.
Yeah, I thought she was going to amount to more here, but this is just sort of a little cameo.
Yeah, weird. She's another one who just a couple years later, she would have another Marvel role.
Right, right.
As the Invisible Woman in Fantastic.
Yep. I guess, I don't know where House of Cards was at this moment on Netflix. Maybe it didn't exist yet, but I know she was...
House of Cards would have been like 2 years from now.
Okay, yeah, because she had a big role in that. Like, I mean, she's recognizable enough, I feel, right? Where you're like, oh, is this... I know her.
Now she is. Now she
maybe
is.
Maybe not here.
But she wasn't at the time.
But that's interesting about this.
It's Attack of the Show, by the way.
Attack of the Show. Right.
Yeah. Olivia Munn.
But the Stan Lee cameo, it's almost like this is so early on, they felt like they had to make him be someone.
Yeah.
And then later in Captain Marvel, he's basically just Stan Lee reading the Mallrats script on a bus, you know? Like
that's right.
It's like, oh, you love it. We don't have to explain it anymore.
Well, it's funny because in the first film, he plays Hugh Hefner.
Right.
Gary Shandling here. He's another character who ends up making a reappearance in the MCU in Captain America: The First Avenger.
Right, late great Gary Shandling.
Oh, sorry, not Captain America: The First Avenger. The Winter Soldier. He's in the late great. Yeah,
right.
What's kind of funny? This is the advantage of films like this existing in a constantly unfolding universe. Is you can do things later that add context earlier.
Yeah.
And so when you watch this, knowing that Senator Stearns is a Hydra agent, mm-hmm. it makes his douchiness slightly more, like, it makes sense.
Yeah. And I gotta say too, I loved this scene. This scene almost felt really like something out of a Sorkin film, like the sort of verbal sparring that these mm-hmm. three men are doing, and then eventually Rhodes. You know, it's kind of thrilling.
Well, I mean, you throw Robert Downey and Sam Rockwell in a scene together, you're going to get something.
You're going to get a smarm off.
Yeah, right?
Right.
If I'm not mistaken, Sam Rockwell was one of the names originally being talked about to play Iron Man
mm-hmm.
With the first film.
Right.
And you can see sort of like a version of that.
Sure.
You know? I like this little affectation. So Justin Hammer is a character from the comic books. He's older and he's a little more sinister. Mm-hmm. And here I think they make him kind of a goof who's constantly trying to live up to Tony. And I like this thing where he calls him Anthony. He's like, well, Anthony, you know, it's almost like he's trying to lord it over him. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like if you call somebody, well, Jeffrey,
right.
You're trying to be, you're being a little bit condescending. Mm-hmm. When you do that, you know.
So now, is this whole conceit, the conceit of this film, basically, where they want him to turn over his tech? Is this from the comics in any way?
Well, it's really not, right? Because when you think about it, from the end of the first movie, the entire move, what became the movie universe. Real quick, I want to point this out. I love this right here. He said, "Hey, I didn't expect to see you here."
Yeah,
and Don Cheadle's like, I'm here. It's me. Deal with it. Let's move on.
Right.
Which is, this is Don Cheadle stepping into Terrence Howard's role.
Right. He very well may just be saying that to the audience, or may as well be
exactly
saying that to the
audience. Look, yep. I'm here. It's me. Let's move on.
Yeah. Rhodes? Is that you?
Yep. I didn't expect to see you here.
Yeah.
Yep. Which, you know, the backstory there is that Terrence Howard was the first actor signed for the first time before even RDJ.
Wow.
And, you know, he was coming off of an Academy Award nomination for Hustle and Flow. Mm-hmm. Big name. And supposedly, Favreau did not have a great experience working with him.
Yeah. Yeah. I read that he was reshooting, cutting his scenes.
Yeah.
Maybe even, I guess, personality conflicts. But
So I think that plus the fact that Robert Downey, his salary skyrocketed from one movie to the next.
Right. Right.
They made that choice. And I always, like, I think it's hard to be entirely objective about Jim Rhodes' character because we're just used to Don Cheadle at this point.
Funny, yeah.
Right? But I think he's better in the role, right? Like,
I like him, obviously, but I've spent more time with him. But
more time with him, yeah.
But yeah, I guess, yeah, I'm reading a little bit more. So Howard took it kind of personally, saying that Downey was taking money that was supposed to go to him.
Yeah, I mean, and you can see his point of view. He's like, I had a contract. Like,
right.
They just, like, it was on the contract. There was a contract, and then there wasn't a contract.
Right.
Which I'd be pissed if you see sort of the train that you're supposed to be on pass you by. I mean, he's done okay because he was in Empire, and I'm assuming he did all right with that. But I do like the way they just kind of got it out of the way, and they just moved on.
Mm-hmm.
I think these days recasting a major character like that would be more challenging.
Yeah, certainly much further down the line. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
By the way, so now, can I just point out real quick his little tech that he uses? It looks like some sort of cell phone. I think to make it look futuristic, it's just glass, right?
And right.
But I was thinking, like, I would never want the back of my phone exposed. You know, so right. People can see what I'm Googling or if I'm in some store
that's
and I'm really
point.
Checking Amazon to see if it's cheaper
real
there.
Real quick. That's a good, yeah. Well, maybe it's not his phone. We just know it's like his little sci-fi thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so that character right there who looks very dead. In Doctor Strange, if you remember, before he gets into his car accident, he gets a phone call saying, yeah, we got an Air Force colonel whose lower spine has been damaged because of some experimental armor.
Ah.
It's meant to be that guy that we just
saw. Oh, that's great.
Which sets, so what that does is it sets Doctor Strange's car crash contemporaneous with the events of this film.
Wow.
Or at some time before. Yeah.
Yeah. Spared so that, nothing.
Yeah.
You know, or you know. As you like to say, you know, every part of the buffalo. They're like,
every part of the buffalo.
Right? It all adds up to something.
and when you think about it, I mean, that gives you a sense of how long Stephen Strange spends, you know, in recovery, about 6 years.
Mm.
Regardless, so you were talking about the comic books and how well this lines up. When you think about it, at the end of the first movie, Tony Stark says, "Yeah, well, here's my look. It's actually my bodyguard, and you know what? Screw it. I am Iron Man." Mm-hmm. Right. Well, that's essentially Kevin Feige and all those people being like, "You know what? Screw it. We're not going to follow the comic books."
Right. Doesn't even say like, "Yeah, I know it's kind of confusing."
Right, exactly. Right. I know it sounds silly.
Right.
And you know why? Because in the comic books, that was the conceit for like ever.
Right.
That Iron Man is a secret Stark employee who serves as Tony Stark's bodyguard.
Right.
Only Tony Stark knows who Iron Man is. Now, the funny thing is that when we say that now, given the context of the movies, we're like, well, that's kind of ridiculous, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But that was just what you went along with.
Now, is that, I don't know if it's as clean as this, but is it sort of a DC thing to have superhero identities, you know, mysterious, whereas Marvel, everyone knows they're just out in the open?
I would say that that is a Marvel movie thing.
Okay.
Because Marvel comic books still did the secret identity thing mm-hmm. for the majority of their characters, notwithstanding the Fantastic Four, up through the mid-2000s. Mm-hmm. And what we saw is starting in the 2000s was gradually they started peeling those away. Steve Rogers revealed his identity to the world. Like, again, comic books, everyone knew Captain America was like a World War II guy, but they didn't know Steve Rogers was Captain America.
I see.
And it was like that, you know?
Yeah.
You know, like they did the whole John Walker story, and it was a big point of that particular storyline that John Walker's like, I'm the new Captain America, but you don't know who I am. And then his identity gets revealed. And that's a big turning point in the story. And the MCU made a choice of saying, we're not going to do secret identities the same way.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's just
Save
how it
some
is.
Time.
But I think, so, I think so. You know, I think it's a little bit of an acknowledgement that it would be a lot harder to do secret identities in the modern era.
Right. Sure.
Right.
And we've kind of seen that dance. Right, with the person trying to hide it from the person closest to them. It's like, you know,
it's funny that you say that, because the early Iron Man comic books where Pepper Potts is his assistant, and it's very much that sense of like, you know, I love her, but how can I tell her when I have this thing in my chest? How can I, you know, it's the really amped up melodrama. And they got rid of that. And Tony Stark reveals his identity, I believe, in the comic book storyline Civil War.
Okay.
Which is what inspired the film, but was tackled in a very different way. Mm-hmm. And the whole thrust of that storyline in the comic book was the government is saying superheroes have to reveal their identities to us in the government. We'll keep them secret, but we need to know who you are. Mm-hmm. And half the superheroes are like, no, we're not doing that. And half of them, led by Tony Stark, are like, yeah, we should do that.
Right.
The movie's just dispensed with it entirely. And I think at this point, it's hard to argue with the efficacy of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because, well, they've done all right so far.
Right. This is a little time capsule thing here, right?
The poster of Iron Man looks like
the Obama hope.
And I think what's interesting is that is itself a sort of pastiche of that poster, but that now is a work of art that you can see people wanting to hang on their wall.
Oh, for sure, right.
The Iron Man Hope poster.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like a lot of the banter between Gwyneth Paltrow and Robert Downey is just them riffing.
Yes.
Right?
I actually, as much as I enjoy Robert Downey Jr. in this role, he can be a bit exhausting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you really are hanging on his every word, because he has a lot of them.
Yeah, I agree.
You know.
That's a really good point.
He speaks like if you had a little spider monkey that you were trying to catch that's just crawling all over you and up your sleeve and out your coat. And you're just like, it's like kind of, you know.
That's another thing that Robert Downey brought to this role that did not exist originally. Mm. You know, Tony Stark in the comic books was pretty much a straight arrow.
Oh, really?
Like he was like sexy, and he's like the guy who's like he's handsome and he's genius and all this, but like the motor mouth, witty one-liners.
Bugs Bunny-ish,
was not
ish.
Yeah. That's Robert Downey. And that's what I find. It to me, that's indicative of how these actors just do something
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
that makes these characters theirs. Right. And with, when you think about it, like when this franchise started, they probably had it in the back of their mind that, well, at some point, Robert Downey's going to be done and somebody else will play Tony Stark. Mm-hmm. Right. And then at some point in those 10 movies or whatever however many he played, it became nope, we're locked
yeah.
in.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
it. When he leaves, the character leaves too, you
yeah,
know?
Yeah. And even once he's passed and you see that sort of, you know, the painting on the wall in the Spider-Man film, it's like we feel Robert Downey Jr.'s Tony Stark Iron Man behind that image, right? You know, I mean, he's made right. such yeah. an impression that who else could step into those shoes?
Yeah, exactly. I remember Mark Wahlberg gave some interviews like, hey, I want to play Tony Stark, okay?
Really?
Yeah. And everyone was like, what?
I love that.
So here is Scarlett Johansson, the second choice to play Natasha Romanoff.
Yeah, I had forgotten all about this. Emily Blunt.
Emily Blunt was the first choice. She wanted to do it. It's like a Tom Selleck, Indiana Jones situation.
Yeah, yeah.
Where Fox was like,
mm-hmm.
We've got a little Gulliver's Travels movie with your name on it.
Jack Black vehicle. Jack. Yeah, that I mean, no disrespect, but I doubt very many people remember it. And
you
got to wonder, at what point did Emily Blunt finally get to let this go? Because that must have been really hard.
That's I think about that, you know, because I hear a lot of like, oh, well, clearly it worked out. Like, they got the right choice. And I'm like, I don't know. I can see Emily Blunt in this role. Like,
they'd be very different. But I can absolutely see it. And I love Scarlett Johansson in this role. I mean, I'm locked into her now and her interpretation of it. But yeah, I mean, of course, Emily Blunt's great. So just would have been different.
And by the way, like, this, the version of Natasha in this is so different from where she ends up.
This was, I told you off mic, but this was the first time I've seen this movie since the theater. So, I mean, basically 11 years ago.
Wow.
And I had a lot of funny feelings with it because now that I'm so entrenched in this universe, you know, many, many movies and many, many years later, it is interesting to see Scarlett Johansson's first stab at this character. But also I had that feeling that you must get all the time where I'm like, teehee, I know who that is. You know, like, which, of course, when I watched this for the first time, I don't know what's going on. I was just following the movie as it was leading me along. Right. But I was just like, I know what she's going to do and who she's going to become. And, you know.
Yeah. Well, and there was definitely, like, by this point, right, this is kind of the interesting, because when the first Iron Man comes out, it's, you know, they're teasing a universe, but there's no promise of anything. Right. But by the time Iron Man 2 comes out, we know for sure next year is Thor and Captain America, the First Avenger.
Sure.
So we know, like, we're in a universe now.
At this point, Samuel L. Jackson, who I guess was sort of hesitant to come back, he has signed his 9-picture deal by now, right?
Yeah, that's right.
So they're at least, they have a roadmap.
That's right. Yeah. I mean, we knew at the very least we were locked in through the Avengers.
Mm-hmm.
So that allowed this movie to contextualize a little bit where you're like, okay, well, if you know the character, you're like, well, we know Natasha is going to show up again. This is her intro to something that's coming later.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I remember at the time that was a critique of this movie. Oh, it's just setting up all this other stuff.
Yeah.
But now you're like, hey, it's setting up all this other stuff.
I was going to say, because I'm sure I had that complaint too. Like, why are we sitting in a donut shop with Nick Fury right now and whatever? But now that I have all of the other pieces to the puzzle, I've enjoyed it in a different way.
Yeah.
Right? Like, it feels more like an episode of television in a series, mm-hmm. right? This is like episode 3 in a 20-episode series.
Which is how you have often described the MCU anyways, just a big TV series.
Yeah, and I don't mean that as a critique, but when you don't realize you're watching a TV series, I thought I showed up for a movie, then you can understand, especially in 2010 when you have no idea.
There's Elon Musk, by the way.
Yeah, right. But you know what I mean? Like, I can view this through a whole different lens now.
Totally
what
agree.
It's, what it's doing.
I should mention the scene that we just saw before this that introduces Natasha, Tony is sparring with Happy Hogan, and that's a little nod to his comic book origins, which is he's a former boxer.
Right. Oh, okay.
Who becomes Tony Stark's bodyguard. In the comic books, Pepper Potts eventually breaks up with Tony, and she marries Happy Hogan.
Oh, huh.
So it's kind of interesting. Like, the comic books... In the comic books, Tony Stark is very much a playboy, but in the films, both him and Steve Rogers, now that I think about it, they did kind of the one true love. approach.
Right.
For both characters.
Yeah.
Speaking of one true love, Leslie Bibb is married to Sam Rockwell.
Yeah, I was just going to point that out. Yeah.
And they've been together since 2007. So I thought, oh, did they meet on this movie? But no, it's just a coincidence.
Yeah. I mean, especially because, right, Leslie Bibb was in the first one. So, I mean,
she was in the first one, and she's actually, her character has continued to appear in universe promo material. So there will be like a MCU newscast that she's the anchor of.
Okay. That's cool.
Yeah. See this scene. I love this. I mean, it's like just his constant, Justin Hammer being so desperate to prove he's anywhere close to Tony Stark.
Right.
Whether in terms of his persona or his level of genius or whatnot, you know?
Yeah, going back to the Elon Musk thing, I wonder, I guess they filmed some scenes at SpaceX. So even though it makes sense for him and Stark to be, you know, sort of socially friendly, I wonder if that was a stipulation too. Like, cool, yeah, you can use my factory. Put me in the movie.
Oh, kind of like Donald Trump, like whenever he would appear in movies.
Right, like Home Alone 2.
It was like, if you're going to use my property, I need to be in
right,
it.
Right, right.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. Yeah.
Now, is this whole Grand Prix thing, this is something from like a comic? I thought I'd read somewhere.
The specific sequence?
Or just him, Iron Man, being involved somewhere with some sort of race?
I think him being a thrill seeker is very much in character.
Okay.
What we see here is an outgrowth of, you know, right after he does his blood test and he sees the clock is ticking. So he's like, you know, I'm going to start taking on these bigger risks.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And you can tell, like, it's a last minute switch because his actual driver, he just pissed him off.
Right, right, right.
You know? I feel like Gwyneth Paltrow has like one mode in this movie, which is just panic.
Yeah. Exasperation.
She's in a constant state of just like, stop.
Yeah. I just in my notes, I put a heading called actors, you know, shrug. Apparently the filmmakers wanted Stark's race car to be Iron Man red, but Robert Downey Jr. insisted on driving the blue and white car. And it's just like, well, sure, Robert. You know, like, and then also Mickey Rourke, I guess, had some sort of like, or wanted a tattoo of Loki on his neck.
That's
and then
right.
The producers were like, look, this is just super confusing. So they had to CGI out that tattoo for the whole movie.
That's right.
I was like, actors, shrug.
Yeah, which is because at the time, Thor was still a year away.
Right.
So it wouldn't even make sense for him to have that tattoo.
Right. They insisted.
So it's you can see the race car color being like a, do we feel like having this fight?
Oh, totally. Sure. Yeah, right. Yeah.
All right, fine.
Yeah, it doesn't really matter. So, by the way, this whole thing now with Rourke sort of ominously approaching and he's going to pull out his electric whips. This was pretty much the only thing I remembered from this movie.
How funny. Yeah, it was in the trailers.
Yeah.
So, and that's the thing. So he plays a character called Whiplash, who's also called Blacklash in the comics, or Backlash. Mm. Not a particularly memorable villain in the comics, which is why they just kind of switched him around and did whatever they did here. But even in this, like, I don't think Rourke makes for a particularly imposing figure at this stage or later in the film. I think that's probably the biggest problem with the movie is your main bad guy, you just don't care about.
Yeah. But as you say that, he does look imposing. He's big and he's got those whips, but I agree with you. So I'm like, why? What's missing?
Right, yeah, and maybe imposing is the wrong word, because, I mean, he looks like a badass, but you're also like, well, Iron Man's going to kick this guy's ass. I think, here's the problem. We have two movies in a row where the villain is somebody who is repurposing Tony Stark's technology.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, demonstrates one of the limitations of the character, if not handled properly, is there isn't a deep bench of bad guys.
Mm.
Iron Man's arch villain in the comic books is the Mandarin, who is a mystical character.
Mm.
And I think that the contrast there of science versus mysticism gives you something interesting.
Right.
The movies said, well, we're just going to we're going to go in a different way.
Right.
It's kind of interesting, actually, because Jon Favreau talked about this. His plan was for the Mandarin to be the villain in the first movie. And he wanted Obadiah Stane to be a presence who would build up to become the Ironmonger in his last one.
Mm.
And they switched it around.
Right.
Right. And I think it worked out. I think Jeff Bridges was a good villain in the first one.
Yeah, I agree.
I think in this, the central conflict is kind of interesting, where you say, Tony Stark is like, I am so far ahead that you don't even need to worry about anybody catching up to my technology. Right. I'll keep you safe. Well, here's a guy who's done it. Now what? That's interesting. Mm-hmm. But the guy who did it is not
particularly
interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And did you see this, where I guess Favreau said that the man who hands Vinko the papers to get to Monaco was, in his headcanon, a member of the Ten Rings?
That's right. Yeah, they actually cut out, you in a longer version of the scene, he has the Ten Rings.
Oh, so that's like legit. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice. Mickey Rourke, yeah. Which, by the way, the wrestler, I didn't realize that was right before this. I mean, I can understand why all the attention was on him. I mean, that was a great movie.
Yeah, I mean, he had a lot of heat.
Yeah, but he is this hulking, understated person in that movie, right? Like, it's not like he brings some sort of huge personality.
Right.
That, like, a villain sort of requires.
I mean, he got an Oscar nomination for that movie, if nothing else, for how far removed it was from what he was probably most known for, right?
Earlier in his career, you mean? Being sort of like...
Yeah, you know, like
handsome
mid
guy.
To late 80s. Yeah, you know.
He looks like a bruiser in that movie. Like, he's just been...
Now, if he should be entirely dead.
Like, yeah, he doesn't have any powers.
Like, yeah, there's no reason he should be alive.
Right. Here. That's hilarious.
I do like here how they refer to the suitcase as the
football. Yeah.
Like, it's the nuclear football.
Yeah. Which, is what is it has the nuclear codes in it for the president.
That's right. Yeah.
you're right. He just keeps, like, in the real world, murdering this person. Like, the stop.
Yeah.
Stop,
he should be
dead.
Squished. Yeah. He should have no legs left. Yeah.
Which, by the way, so this was the last time Brian accepted the reality of a portable Iron Man suit. This case, I was like, I'll buy this, before it became a bunch of electronic gnats.
I was thinking about that as I was watching it, because I like the suit up sequence here, because there is a practical reality to
it. Totally. It's right? It's insane, but it's like, yeah, I'll buy that.
Yeah, here's a suitcase, you put your thing in here, and then and it got more and more ridiculous. In the Avengers, we get
that walkway.
Which works,
yep.
Right? And then if you remember, he, like, Loki throws him out the window, and there's, like, the rocket thing that kind of... Okay, that's about it. Because they kept going further and further towards... It says, oh, here, it just, let me hit a little button and bloop, there it is.
Yeah, nanotech.
I'm so done with
I'm not a nanotech guy, but you know what? I even read where they said that the technology of the first Iron Man was already catching up to reality, so they wanted to get ahead of it. So they're like, all right, look, this is something that doesn't exist that you can kind of understand, even though it makes no sense. Nanotech. You know, I'm like, I get it, I guess.
The suitcase armor is, in fact, a conceit that was in the comics all the time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it wasn't exactly like this, but the idea that he can carry it in his briefcase, mm-hmm. that works for me.
Yeah.
I
love it. Him putting his fists in there and it pulling, more pieces that sort of extend out. Like, it's realized incredibly well.
That's and if you remember in the third one, they do the thing where he implants, like, trackers into his own body.
So
that he can summon the suit. Remember that?
Yeah.
And then, I can buy that as a concept. But I think ultimately I'm like, this thing, there needs to be it has to be believable that this is a thing you got to put on.
Sure.
And so that's. It's such a, I call nanites hand wavium.
Yeah. Gosh, I forgot I had that joke and I didn't write it down last night. I was gonna say, like, unobtainium in Avatar. I was gonna say it should be, like, made of, like, nonsensium.
Yeah, right.
Wow, that's so funny. I forgot about that. Yeah.
It's like, I mean, because they did it in Black Panther also.
Yeah, and, yeah, sure.
And it's just, it's like, I get it where we need to see the actor's face.
Yeah.
You know, so it's because they do the same thing in Guardians of the Galaxy where Star-Lord's like, boop, brr, right? And there's his face.
Right.
But you're like, space technology.
Sure,
you know?
Sure.
But with each one, like, you're having to buy a little more, you know?
That would be, been done where, like, a bunch of nanite tech things go into a person's mouth and then expand inside and kill them?
I feel like you saying it is now,
I'm putting it out there.
It's going to show up in some Blumhouse
movie. Yeah, I was going to say, that could be like some horror movie or something.
Yeah. You wonder if Mickey Rourke sitting there naked was like a Mickey Rourke idea.
I was thinking about that last night. Yeah. Yeah. Or I wasn't thinking about that specifically, but I was like, man, that must have been like a day where he's just sitting there in his underwear on this bench, you know?
Yeah. He was like very kind of Bruce Willis-esque in the 80s, right? In terms of his appearance, you know?
Yeah, right. I mean, I think of Diner, right? Was sort of.
Yeah, that's right.
Which is kind of a talky young guy's ennui movie, right? But then eventually, yeah, I guess I don't really know. I know he did like Blue Orchid, which was like some sort of erratic thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm not super familiar with him in the 80s, I guess. But then he all of a sudden went from this kind, he looks like, he did become a boxer, right? An actual true to life boxer, because he looks sort of beat up now. Way different than he looked in the early part of his career.
Yeah. I mean, he's like leathery now.
Yeah.
Well, and he's 68 now. So he's probably in his late 50s when he did this.
Sure.
I mean, but he doesn't look like he's in his late 50s. He looks older.
Yeah. Yeah.
Here, you know?
Yeah. I mean, he looks like a fighter.
Yes.
Right? Someone who's been sort of beat up as a profession.
I mean, it's, I think he started as a boxer and then he went into acting and then he went back to boxing and then he's been back and forth a few times. I think as recently as 2014, he boxed again.
Oh, wow.
Right.
Yeah, why not? I guess.
I mean, 24, he would have been in his mid-60s at that point.
Wow.
Damn.
It's like Foreman and all these guys, right?
Even Tyson, right?
He wanted to fight again. Exhibition stuff. This was one of those things where they're on the jet and they're looking at Gary Shandling on the TV. I always wonder about all that scrolling stuff at the bottom. Who came up with all that fake news tech stuff, you know, just like
one of
them I saw, because I paused it at this moment to go, food arrived or something, and it says like Dow Jones
down like 100,
yeah, down something. Thanks to today's event. And I was like, yeah, all right, that makes sense. Yeah, like
which, and I think that's actually something that these early MCU films do a pretty good job of, right? Which is situating these fantastical events within something resembling our world.
Yeah, I like that too.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, yeah, the technology may be a bit, you know, a decade ahead of us, but it does feel like they exist in the real world.
Like if we think of this as a superhero universe, really, as far as the public is concerned, the first fantastical thing to happen is the appearance of Iron Man.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because like Captain Marvel, we find out later, was kind of like secret and kept, you know, like they found ways to kind of be like, oh, well, a bunch of stuff happened, but that nobody knew about. Mm-hmm. But starting with Iron Man, suddenly all this stuff is in the public eye.
Right.
And when you look at, for example, these early films, even the Avengers, and contrast it to, for example, Infinity War and Endgame, both of which I love, I think a critique is they feel very insular within our roster of characters.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But we don't have a real sense of like, well, how is the world dealing with all this?
Yeah.
Right? Like even the 5 years later jump, we get a little bit of it. But for the most part, everything that happens in Endgame, it's in and around our characters.
Mm-hmm.
And they can do that because the roster is so big.
Right. Right. Populate your whole movie with,
Yeah, yeah, right.
But yeah, how does Johnny on the street feel about these people? And do they wear, I'm sure they do, but like Captain America shirts and have their favorites? Right. And,
you know? Yeah. I mean, the television series Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. initially existed alongside these movies.
Mm-hmm, right.
And so that really did allow you to get this window into, well, here's how the rest of the world is seeing mm-hmm. it. You know, and then even that show at about the halfway point, it kind of just went its own direction. And so it stopped intersecting with what the movies were doing.
Right.
So I think it's kind of a shame.
Was this Marvel related or was this completely independent where there was some sort of TV show or movie that was about the people who clean up the messes caused by the superheroes?
So that is a, that was a comic book called Damage Control.
Okay.
And that's the whole bit. They incorporated that concept into the universe in Spider-Man Homecoming.
Mm.
Where they say that it's a new branch of the government, the Department of Damage Control. Right. And if you remember, you know, New York has a contract with Michael Keaton and his group to clean up all the crime.
Right, 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 right.
And he blames Tony Stark for taking away his employment.
Right.
So a little bit of that by virtue of what we see in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
So this is Elon Musk's SpaceX facility, this hangar.
I love this is one of those things where I had to imagine the reality of this, where they have this nice meal in this hangar, which obviously looks great on film, but I'm like, where's the cook? Like, where did he get the gas for the stove? Like, feels very inconvenient, but it looks great. Makes an impression.
Well, I think what you say there is, I think, really crucial. It says something about Justin Hammer.
The lengths he's willing to go to.
Yeah, he constantly is trying to present yes. himself as being more than he is.
Right.
You know? And yet he's just like a petulant kid.
Right.
You see him constantly. He's eating like lollipops. And over here, he's eating
dessert
like,
first. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow, good point. Like, I didn't even think about that.
Like later on, I'm going to take your bird away. You know,
yeah,
it's like,
yeah. I love that. I didn't think about the dessert first and lollipop thing. That's good.
I think this character is so interesting. It would be an absolute shame not to bring him back.
I agree.
In some capacity.
I agree.
You know?
Why not? Now that Stark's gone, right? I mean, now he feels like he can take the mantle.
That's the beauty of it, because, you know, they have a thing in development called Armor Wars, which is based on a comic book storyline where Iron Man's technology gets stolen. It's being used by criminals.
Mm.
And so he's essentially goes on this mission to hunt down every armored person in the Marvel comic book universe and get his technology back. Right. And it turns out that it's like a rival industrialist. And I'm like, well, they're doing that as a miniseries. They're doing it starring Don Cheadle.
Mm.
And I'm like, Justin Hammer, what a perfect way to bring him back in.
Yeah. Yeah. Armor Wars feels like a show on like History Channel or something that my dad would like.
That's right.
You know what was distracting me in the scene was Rockwell's hands.
Oh, he's kind of just going all over the
place. No, they look like they have bronzer on them.
Oh, that's right.
And I was like, is that from shaking Mickey Rourke's hands from like multiple takes or like what's the
Oh, wow. Good call.
Right?
Wow.
Isn't it like that's it was totally standing out to me last night.
It looks like it came off of Mickey Rourke.
Right.
Because it's not I mean Justin Hammer doesn't have a fake bake.
No, doesn't look like it.
Yeah. How funny.
That was kind of funny, this whole thing of him wanting his bird. He's like, okay, the bird, it's in Russia. Like,
yeah. You
I wonder when the first, okay, so CNN now, you know, talking about made up fictional news. I wonder when the first news station, you know, Walter Cronkite, I could see him being like, hey, we want you to do a news report that's going to be in Dr. Strangelove. And he's like, absolutely not. No, I can't the integrity that I bring with the American people. Like I and they see me saying things that aren't true. This news report.
America trusts me, damn it.
Yeah. It's like a War of the Worlds situation. If they hear me saying this, that aliens are arriving, they'll believe it. And I wonder at one point, who was the first news anchor to be like, yeah, I'll do that. You imagine it'd be Ron Burgundy, honestly. I mean, like me in a movie, you know, but now, you know, you have Wolf Blitzer and Mission Impossible. Like, hello.
You know? Yeah. I mean, like what anchor hasn't been in a movie, you know, playing themselves.
Yeah.
So the character of James Rhodes is an interesting one because in the comic books, he's like a long time, assistant to Tony Stark. He's like, he's his pilot.
Mm.
But he's former military. He's not military. I think it's interesting that the movies, they made the choice of being like, no, he's going to be active duty.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that's a good choice or bad choice. I think it's interesting because it adds this sense of like, he has the weight of the military behind him.
Right.
War machine.
Right.
But I think this film echoes some of what happened in the comic books because in the alcoholism storyline, Tony Stark relapses. And so Jim Rhodes ends up putting on the armor in an emergency. And then he ends up becoming Iron Man for a little while Tony Stark recovers.
Huh.
And then later on, Tony Stark is just like he's like Mr. Burns. He has every illness imaginable.
All at once.
He just goes through. Yeah. And so there's a storyline where his whole nervous system is shutting down and he's dying. And so he fakes his death and he bequeaths the whole company and the Iron Man armor, which at the time was the War Machine armor, to Jim Rhodes. And so he becomes Iron Man. And then when Tony Stark eventually comes back, he keeps the armor and he calls himself War Machine.
Okay.
And in this film, the path that the character goes through echoes that, where Tony has chosen him to take the armor. Right. I mean, we find out later we'll get there, but you know, he wanted him to get the armor.
Right.
So it's very much an illustration of that. I like the friendship between these two characters.
Yeah.
Yeah. Same. I like it as something from the comic books, and I like that the movies kept that.
Yeah.
You know, I think in the third one, there's even more, I mean, which I guess makes sense. Shane Black, there's a very buddy cop relationship between them.
I got to watch that one again.
That's another one that I'm willing to wager you haven't seen it since 2013.
Yeah. Yeah. You're right.
Right.
What is that drink that Tony's drinking? That has something to do with his health, right?
Yeah, it's like a chlorophyll type energy thing.
So he's trying to keep whatever toxicity at bay.
It's keeping that, and I think it's probably as you know, it's like a substitute for his alcohol dependency.
Interesting.
It's in essence, because you see him constantly having to drink that. I think in a sense the idea that he's being poisoned by the palladium and that's making him more and more self-destructive, that's as close as the movies will get to the idea of his substance abuse. And I wonder about that because, you know, when Robert Downey was first cast in the role, a lot of the commentary was like, oh, it's so similar to his own struggles.
Right.
Robert Downey struggles. And yet the film Tony Stark really did not go down that road very much.
Right.
You know,
it's totally random note. But when I was sort of paying attention to that drink, it's like, what is that? And then I saw his water bottle. Yeah. I was like, hey, that's kind of cool. And so I Googled it and I found it on Amazon for like $40. And I was like, it's not that cool.
It's not $40 worth of cool.
I do love this whole notion, though, about this thing that's keeping him alive is killing him.
Yeah, and the idea that what happens when the smartest man alive can't solve a problem.
Right, right.
Like, how helpless do you feel, right?
Right. It's interesting, too.
It is interesting.
Yeah.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say this relationship between him and Natasha.
I was
knowing,
literally just about to say that.
Yeah, like him flirting with her so much. And just because she's, I guess, sort of undercover, she sort of rolls with it. But it's just knowing who she is. It's just like, oh, is she going to take that?
That's you sort of wonder, like, what is her mission?
Mm.
Right, above and beyond keeping, you know, she says later, like, oh, we found out you were sick, so I had to keep an eye on you. But what is she, how has she been told to engage with
mm-hmm,
him?
Mm-hmm.
You know, do you indulge him, you know?
Right.
Are you trying to get inside his head? Are you trying to figure him out, you know?
Right.
So, Brian, if this was the last birthday you were going to have, how would you celebrate it?
Do whatever I wanted with whoever, whatever she just said. I don't know. The caption went too fast. You know what? Honestly, to really answer that question, I thought I just read somewhere that Jeff Bezos was going to go to space very shortly. And I was like, really? Like, are you sure you want to be on that early of a flight up there? Like, who knows what's going to happen? But if this was my last birthday, I think I would really love to go on one of those commercial flights into space.
I can dig
it. Seems dangerous in this moment in time, but hey, if it's my last birthday, let's see if it works. Yeah,
you only live once.
I've always thought it would be incredible to see the Earth from space.
There you go. Look at that. See that? You come here for the Marvel Comics factoids. And as a bonus, you get Brian Hall opening up.
What about you? Did you throw a birthday like this?
yeah, I'd just pee on myself and whatever else Tony Stark does here.
Actually, it would be hilarious if it was like you rented like a really nice Iron Man costume and just got drunk and had some DJ and, you know, invited a bunch of people you don't know and just like, ah, making a spectacle out of yourself.
It really, like, this movie, we were talking about how Pepper is just exasperated throughout. Rhodey, kind of the same thing. It's just people being exasperated by
kind
Tony
Stark.
Kind of fed
up with Tony, yeah.
Yeah.
Which, again, you know, it for Iron Man 2, what we showed up in the theaters for when this is the, like, third film, might have felt like, is that really how I want to spend time with my hero? But 20-plus movies later, it's like, this is a chapter. Right. And I don't mind this chapter. You know, it's part of his journey.
I agree with that. The DJ, by the way, that's DJ AM.
Right.
Who passed away before the movie even came out. The movie's dedicated to him at the end. I believe he had a drug overdose.
That was really funny when he's scratching the record, Tony, and he's just like, thank you. You know, like...
I think, you know, the Infinity Saga, as it's now known, I call it, as much as it is the Infinity Saga, it's also the Stark arc.
That's good. Yeah.
You know, because when you watch it in its entirety, you go on these hills and valleys with this character and all of the sort of digressions and whatnot are made interesting,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I think what we set up in this movie vis-a-vis his relationship with his father, which, to be fair, that's also alluded to in the first one, but that sense of like things left unsaid, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, his father leaves that message for him. I love how, if you stick with all films and you make it all the way to Endgame, that pays off meaningfully, you know, in a couple different ways, you know,
the father relationship.
Yeah, like I think that ends up being kind of an important part of his whole character arc. Because of course, what we see in Civil War, you know, with the finding out that Bucky killed
Spence. Yeah, yeah.
Right. And then getting the chance to talk to his dad again, you know.
Right.
Before he dies.
Actually, I was sort of like baiting you a little bit because I couldn't remember the Endgame thing, but I do remember the revelation about Bucky.
So in Endgame, when he goes back to the 1970s, he meets his dad.
Yeah. Right. His dad, I got to watch that again.
Right. Because that is at the time when his dad and well, his mom too, they're expecting Tony.
Yeah.
And his dad's like, the kid's not even here yet, and I'd do anything for him, you know?
Yeah.
And it's that for, you know, because in this, he talks about, like, my dad was cold and distant. He never said he loved me. His happiest day of his life was when I shipped out to boarding school. You know, that's what he carries with him, right?
Yeah.
And so to have that resolve is so important for his own for his own culmination as a character.
Right. His Stark arc.
You know. The Stark arc. Yeah.
You know, it's funny. So now that Rhodes is in a suit and they're sort of fighting, I was like, you know, when this started, I was feeling like, okay, so they're just going to smash into each other for like 10 minutes and, you know, I'm kind of ready to move on. But then I actually started really enjoying watching it. Like, it was,
well, real quick, yeah. Look at this right here. Look at Natasha. Look at how she gets into that fighting stance.
Oh, I didn't even
notice. Did you notice that? Like, when they fall through right away,
she's ready to go.
Right. And I was like, this little touch.
That's good.
Yeah. But I agree with what you're saying. I mean, I think knowing where things are headed allows you the flexibility to just be like, let's just go with it.
Yeah. And I just, even just credit to the filmmakers. I mean, it's pretty well done. I mean, it looks, when he throws him up through the ceiling and he lands in that bedroom, and it looks
right.
Good.
Yeah. I do like how at this moment here, or very shortly thereafter, we have Tony be like, oh, so you want to be the War Machine? Like, they have to find a way to include
the
superhero name in it.
Yeah.
That's such a thing in these superhero movies where you can't just be like, from this day forth, I shall be.
Right.
That's in Aquaman a couple of years ago, that was something that I like kind of appreciated, was where, what's his name? Patrick Wilson's like, no, call me Ocean Master.
Right.
I was like, all right. Hey, that's what this movie
is. I like that. Yeah.
It's a super villain name out loud movie.
Yeah, you know? Right. Yeah.
I should say the song that was playing when they're fighting, that's It Takes Two. And whenever I hear that, I think of the very brief time in the summer of 2000 when I worked at American Eagle Outfitters. Because that song was like on the CD.
Oh, really?
It was on constant play.
It takes two to make a thing go right.
It was the American Eagle at Stratford Square Mall. So
Stratford Square. This is going to be like our Seinfeld Superman, where we have to drop some sort of Stratford reference.
Some reference.
Is that like Lake Wobegon? Whatever. What's his name? Jeez. Keeler? Is that right?
Garrison.
Yeah, Garrison Keeler, right? He's always talking about Lake Wobegon.
That's right.
Gus is like, it's Stratford Square.
Garrison Keeler, is he still alive?
I don't believe so.
He is still
alive. He is. Oh, I thought he had passed.
As of June 2021, Garrison Keeler is still with us.
Oh, huh. Fly by the tower.
So this actor, and not this guy, but the one to the left of the screen here, he's also in the first Iron Man.
Oh, really?
And gosh, I wish I could remember his name. He's one of those character actors. You see him in a whole bunch of, he's just like one of those guys who's in it.
Yeah. That looked really good, by the way, where it looked like the camera was on his back as he approached the hangar.
Yes.
You know, for as much as I think, you know what it is sometimes when you lose your handle on visual effects is when almost everything is created. But when you just insert a thing into something that looked like they actually did shoot that physically, you're just like, damn, that guy's flying. You know, it looks really
agree.
Good.
I totally agree. Oh, and Tim Guinea was that actor's name, by the way. And he's like, again, he's just one of those guys like, you've seen him in a ton of different things.
Mm. Oh, this was, I remember this too, but I couldn't remember which film it was in. Him and the Randy's Donuts donut.
That was in the trailer. I remember that for sure.
It's over near LAX airport.
Is that, I mean, that's kind of like a tourist attraction.
Totally LA iconic.
Yeah.
However, the inside, I had to look it up because I was like, wait, there's an interior. It's like kind of a drive up place. And this is a Yum Yum's donut in the same neighborhood a couple blocks away.
Oh, okay.
I wonder how Yum Yum's felt, where it's like, hey, we're going to put Randy's signs all over your place here. So so anyone who watches this movie and wants to visit it, we'll go to the other place.
So they just as they lowballed Mickey Rourke, they lowballed Sam Jackson.
Mm.
And Marvel at this stage, this is pre Disney, was notoriously skimpy in terms of the money that they were willing to spend. And it's because, you know, Ike Perlmutter was the guy running it. And so, essentially, Sam Jackson was just willing to walk away. Right. And you know, later on, what we saw were where Kevin Feige got elevated to being sort of the boss of bosses. It was as a result of this. He's like, I can't make deals with my talent when this guy's the one signing all the checks. And so that's why they set it up so that he answers directly to the head of Disney. So that they're able to cut through that. And that's, and I think when you look at the things that the Marvel films have been able to do later, where they, you know, they made a deal with Robert Downey to come back for, you know, cause his contract ran through, I think, the second Avengers movie.
Okay.
But they made a deal to come back for in, for Captain America Civil War and et cetera, et cetera. All those, all the big money deals would not have been able to happen under the framework of these early movies.
Right.
So Sam Jackson, I mean, he signed a 9-picture deal, but when you think about it, like, he comes out ahead because for most of those movies, he just has to show up for like a scene.
Yep.
And be like, hey, so what's going on here?
Right. Everything good? Yeah. Great.
Yeah. All right. See you later. Like, I mean, he gets a fair amount of screen time in Avengers, which is 2 years after this. But I mean, on balance, notwithstanding the first Avengers movie, He gets a scene or two in each of the movies he shows up in. Captain Marvel, I guess he's got a pretty big storyline there.
Right. Yeah, he gets all de-aged and everything.
That's right. He also, I always say this, like, he was in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. at least a couple times during the first season.
Oh, really? Oh,
yeah,
wow.
Like, and that's why I'm always like, people, because I'm like a defender of that show, where I'm like, look, if you get hung up on canon and it doesn't count, I'm like, I hate to break it to you, but none of this is real.
Right.
I'm like, but you can watch a thing and enjoy it, you know? And I'm like, it just construct whatever, whatever connections you need to make in your head to make it work, but it's worth watching. Yeah. It's a good show. The end.
The end. Or you don't have to watch it.
Or don't watch it. Exactly.
Yeah.
Don't bitch about it though. Don't bitch, people.
Yeah. Quit your bitching.
It's the bitching. It's the bitching that I don't like.
It's the bitching I don't like. I like that.
I love here how Ivan, throughout the film, just at least as part of his relationship with Hammer, he keeps downgrading what to expect, and each time Hammer has, there's nothing he can do about it.
Right.
He's like, I build you suit. Okay, I build you drone.
Right.
It cannot demonstrate. It salute. You know, like.
Yeah.
And he can do all of it, but what's he doing? He's focusing on his project, right?
I'm trying to think, because he's sitting here chewing on his toothpick, leaning over, completely in control or command here. What do you do to make this villain more memorable? You know, like.
That's a good question.
I mean, he's doing his job,
yeah.
But like, why? I don't know what it is. I mean, an actor who has some sort of, like you're saying with Robert Downey Jr. and all these people who are bringing their Downey Jr.-ness to this, and they become inextricable from the characters. I mean, is there, you know, like you bring in like a Pacino, and he's like, oh, this is not my bird, you know, like,
oh,
yeah.
I gotta tell you.
Right, like
these drones, they're not gonna work.
Oh, you're gonna love them. Yeah. You know,
I think the idea of Ivan Vanko being like the opposite number of Tony Stark, there's something interesting there.
Yeah.
Because Tony Stark is like the only person on Earth who could build an arc reactor. Here's the guy who's smart enough to do the same thing.
Right.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
But what makes these guys different? What makes them similar? You know, I mean, we get that one scene with them together where they're in the jail cell. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of interesting, but it almost feels like that was part one of a scene that we needed to pay off later.
Mm, sure.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, this seems like a very blue screen.
Wow, that's so funny. I was thinking that last night. I was like, they probably just built this on a set and they're like, yeah, put like some blue screen of something that looks like Malibu in the background.
It's funny because nowadays with these Marvel movies, you just assume it's all, like, they don't even have actors in the same shot together.
Yeah.
You know, and you go with it because for the most part, it looks fine,
right?
You know, but like these early ones, there was still more of a sense of like, let's actually put them in a place. Mm-hmm. See what happens. I mean, just compare Thor 1 to Thor 3.
sure.
Right? And I like them both. They're fine. But I mean, you know, in the first Thor, yeah, he's like in an actual town and he's like walking around and there's people, you know? And then in the third one, it's just a bunch of Ragnarok-y rolling around. Yeah.
I mean, to be fair, though, I don't really care during this scene. I mean, I imagine... They had to build a chunk of this house, recreate it, right, and put it somewhere, and you want to control your environment and where the sun is, right, if the sun's shining on them, and they're going to shoot for 12 hours.
Yeah, it's used as an easy critique of the Marvel movies. Mm. Oh, it's all against the green screen. And I'm like, well, without the green screen, you're not going to get to see most of this.
yeah.
So, you know, I mean, it's like, look... Pick your poison, you know?
You know what, though? I think there's, and in defense of it is what I'm going to get at, is that the more fantastical elements you invite into the frame, it's almost like it all needs to feel of a piece in some sort of way, right? Yeah. So I don't know. If only a third of it is like that, it's just not going to look right. So if you just sort of make the whole thing look kind of washed out and a certain sort of thing, like you just buy... the world you're looking at in the whole frame.
Right. No, I agree with that.
Thank you.
This,
sorry. <Go ahead.
laughs> the robe that Tony's wearing, that is, his dad's robe. And we see that later in there's a one shot, an Agent Carter one shot that was released on the Blu-ray of Iron Man 3, where we see Dominic Cooper as the young Howard Stark wearing that exact robe.
And that's the only time we can make that correlation?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Be sure to tip Zachy on the way out. That's great. So all this S.H.I.E.L.D. stuff, right? Well, I mean, this has to do with the plot, but back to the donut place and all that. I mean, that was a point of frustration for Jon Favreau, right? I mean, is that why he didn't come back for Iron Man 3?
Yeah, I think that was really it. It's with the first movie, you know, it was kind of punk rock, right? They got to just do their own thing. And then suddenly it becomes a success, and suddenly now you're one cog in this machine. Mm-hmm. And so your choices start getting taken away from you, but the blame gets apportioned to you anyway.
Right.
And I think he felt a little bit of that. You know, there was the frustration of the making of the film, and then it wasn't as well received as the first film.
Right. It's sort of like Wayne in Wayne's World. They were like, hey, why don't you mention Noah's Arcade? I mean, I don't want to bow down to any sponsor. Yeah.
I think that's true.
You know,
I'm sure Favreau, because when he signed on for this one, it included being an executive producer on The Avengers. Mm-hmm. And so I think in his mind, he's like, you know what? I got the ball rolling.
Right.
I get to cash out on all of it anyway.
Right.
So let somebody else handle the day-to-day stuff, you know?
Yeah, and again, I mean, we were saying earlier, you can look back now in hindsight with appreciation for what they were building, but I can't imagine when you're just working on the sequel of this thing and there's only three movies, you're like, like you're ruining my movie. You know,
I mean, Brian, when you think about it, the frustration that Favreau voiced with regards to this movie are very similar to the frustrations that Joss Whedon voiced with regards to the second Avengers.
Right.
You know, and it kind of tells you that in the industry, oftentimes nothing fails faster than success, because the expectations rise and there's more pieces involved, and you know, both Iron Man 2 and Avengers: Age of Ultron were essentially middle chapters,
laying
pieces in place for other stuff. So you're not as able to be self-contained and really tell your own story,
right?
And I think it tells you something about this movie. I love this, by the way, how much he hypes up his little missile there.
Dude, I was actually going to, I wrote this quote down because it is so freaking brilliant. The whole thing, like, what does he say? Like, if it was any smarter, it'd write a book. It'd make Ulysses look like it was written in crayon. It would read it to you.
And which, by the way, Ulysses, at the time James Joyce wrote it, was going blind. So actually, he did write a lot of it in crayon.
Get out of here.
That's true. Oh,
I did not know that.
Yeah.
I just know Ulysses is a famously dense book.
Yes. Yeah. He does such a good job delivering this dialogue.
Oh, yeah.
I think what Rockwell does is he makes Justin Hammer kind of lovable.
Yeah, sure.
Right? Even though he's awful.
Right.
I like the symmetry here where in the first movie, if you remember, when it came to build the arc reactor, when Obadiah Stane was trying to get, Ralphie from Christmas Story to build the arc reactor.
Right.
He says, Tony Stark was able to build this with a box of scraps.
Yeah.
And now here's another box of scraps that he has to turn to save his life.
That's good. It's funny when you said Ralphie, immediately, of course, I think of A Christmas Story, but I didn't know where you were going. I was like,
it's the guy, right?
Yeah, Peter Billingsley.
It's Peter Billingsley, that's right.
Pal of Jon Favreau.
And you gotta love how a total tertiary character like that ends up coming back into play in the MCU. In Spider-Man Far From Home last year, 2 years ago.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
That's what these movies can do. That's the fun of having an expanded playground like this.
Yeah. And people who are just completely immersed in it and care about it.
Yeah. And I mean, I think that's, I love that there. Like his image of his dad has never stopped being that, mm-hmm. what he just saw, being the taskmaster and get mad
shooing
at him. And
then
but here he's like screwing around, he's being a regular guy.
Right.
And this is, Tony never saw this.
Right.
In his life, and it allows him to relate to him as a person. And then we get the great him talking, him across time, mm-hmm. Speaking to his son,
Yeah.
I mean, it's weird how a movie like this or a universe like this, and it's so much of it is about the relationship that the father has with the son and how how that plays out over the development of a person. I think about it in terms of my kids all the time, like what am I doing? Am I screwing them up?
Right.
Like, I don't know, and there's that sense of like, obviously you want to be caring, you want to be compassionate, you want to make sure that they know how much you are proud of them, but you also have to be firm,
right,
and stern,
mm-hmm.
And it's like, what are they thinking of?
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, what are they taking? Are they then learning from this and growing and getting stronger? Or are they like, man, why didn't dad just
help
me out?
Come on, you got to love the symmetry of Tony's father talks to him, from beyond the grave. And then he talks to his own daughter at the end of Endgame through that holographic message.
Yeah. I love that they shot this scene, by the way. This whole thing with the strawberries?
Yes.
Like, they didn't have to shoot this.
I was thinking that.
I thought that last night, but I like it. Like, I love him just paying with his probably like $10,000 watch for like a box of strawberries.
Right. Well, what's great is that watch, that's given to him in the first one by Obadiah Stane.
Good Lord.
So it doesn't mean anything.
Zachy on the way out. Man, I did not know that.
Now, that secretary there, that's Mrs. Arbogast, Bambi Arbogast. She's actually a character from the comic books.
Ah, wow.
That was one thing. I've said this on the show before. I was a big Iron Man comic book fan, mm-hmm. growing up, And I always say, like, that was, that was a sign of fandom. Because nobody was an Iron Man comic book fan.
right.
But I read it throughout the 80s, throughout the 90s, And one of the things I liked about the comic books is there was a whole group of corporate people that were part of his circle.
Mm-hmm.
Mrs. Arbogast and like the Stark attorney, Felix Alvarez, and all these characters, you know, that's something that always disappointed me, that the movies never really got into the culture at Stark Industries, you know?
So you say that, you know, it wasn't like reading, you know, Batman or Captain America or something. So what drew you to Iron Man?
Even Captain America was not like one of the top tier books.
Oh, sure.
That's,
or Spider-Man,
I mean,
let's say that.
Yeah. What drew me to Iron Man? That's a good question.
In that era.
You know, it was my brother read it, mm-hmm. and so I just got into it because of him.
Right.
I always liked the character, you know, but that's kind of the interesting thing is Marvel in the 80s and certainly into the 90s, like the Avengers characters were not big sellers. Mm-hmm. So Captain America, Thor, Iron Man, and even the Avengers books, like now they're so ubiquitous. It's hard to even imagine.
Right. That. Right.
But at Marvel, the marquee books were X-Men and Spider-Man, which is why those were the movies that got made first.
Yeah.
Those were the movies that did not get made by Marvel. So Iron Man being first was, you know, it's like the schmutz that's left in the drain.
Right.
Nobody else wanted it. And it just so it became one of the biggest franchises in the world, but it was first out the chute out of sort of desperation. Well, this is all we got. Let's make the most of it. Go figure.
Wow. I know it's hard to put yourself back in that time. You know, it's
like I remember me as a fan of the character in the comics being so excited. I was like, oh, Robert Downey. That's great. I can totally see that. But I mean, the general perception was like, really? Iron Man?
Right.
You're doing Iron Man, you know?
Right. And didn't they want Tom Cruise or something?
Yeah, they did. If you read Iron Man comic books from like 2004 or so, drawn by Adi Granov, who was actually one of the concept artists for these movies, he drew Tom Cruise as Tony Stark.
Okay.
Like it's not even up for debate. That is Tom Cruise that he drew. And he negotiated. Like I don't think he dismissed it out of hand. Mm-hmm. But it didn't work out. But it's just hard to imagine.
Yeah.
Like you can, I'm sure that version would have been something.
Oh yeah, sure.
But it wouldn't have been this.
Yeah. You know? But you can imagine at the time, I mean, all of this felt sort of like a gamble, right? Robert Downey Jr. on the back on the up and up.
Well, Robert Downey himself was a gamble, which, I think we talked about this in our commentary for the first film. The studio didn't want it. And, you know, Jon Favreau had to push and push and push to even get him an audition. Right. And you can watch his screen test online, Robert Downey's, and you watch it and you're like, he nailed it instantly. Mm. He got it. Like he got the job
right
before he was done. You know,
I'd like to look that up.
This thing with the little
hilarious
spinning thing on the desk. That was just improvised on.
I was going to say it's really smart because it adds something to the entire scene.
Yes.
Right. Like you can't keep your eyes off of it and it's so distracting and him calling it out, but it's still there. Like it adds this extra tension or something that keeps you sitting up straight while there's a lot of talking going on.
I do love the thing with the strawberries where she's like, did you get me strawberries?
Yeah.
Did you know there's one thing on this earth I'm allergic to? And he's like, strawberries. See, I knew there was a connection.
Yeah, that's
That's, I think what you mentioned earlier, right. About how, this character, a little can go a long way as far as spending time with Tony Stark. And so finding, like coming right up to the edge of the character being endearing versus being obnoxious.
Right.
It's tricky.
Yeah. It's tightrope.
You know? And I think certainly, maybe not so much in this one, but in some of the later appearances, he gets right up there to the edge of that line.
Sure.
You know, so you're like, all right, Tony, let's like dial it down, maybe like by two. Yeah.
That's a funny shot, by the way, that we just saw on the freeway where he has the model all bunched up in his car.
Yeah. Kind of like, did he carry that up by himself?
I thought about that too, but he strikes me as the type of person that would.
That he'd just do it himself?
You know, I love this tech also, where they just scan the model and then he can raise it up in the air and spin it around. It feels like we will be able to do that in our lifetime. But it's just out of reach, right?
Just out of reach.
But it makes complete sense. all this sort of Minority Report thing he's doing with his hands, you know, waving things away, expanding things.
It's also the, you know, the working through a problem with Jarvis scene, which we get in all three of the Iron Man films. Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny because Paul Bettany, obviously he's rightly given acclaim for what he did as Vision, but I think we don't give enough credit for what he did as Jarvis,
mm-hmm.
which is like, you have to play a computer with a personality,
yeah,
but not too much of right. a personality, but, and he found this exact rhythm
mm-hmm.
that allows sort of this banter back and forth, you know?
Right.
I mean, it's a trick.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. It's just enough of a personality to remember it.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you do feel bad for Paul Bettany because he went from having the easiest job in the MCU to probably the hardest.
Right. Putting all that purple stuff on his face. Yeah.
here, show up in an afternoon, just say a bunch of stuff. Here's your bag of money with the dollar sign on it. You know? And then now it's like, all right, show up at 2 a.m.
Yeah.
And we'll be ready to shoot you at 2 p.m. You know?
Yeah. I love that this one little helper arm has such a personality that I feel like, oh, I remember that guy from the first movie.
Yeah, that's Dummy.
Yeah. I love this aspect of Stark also, where it's like, once he commits to some sort of mission or purpose, he's like, yeah, he doesn't even care. He takes a jackhammer to his own million-dollar mansion, just, you know, he can't be stopped.
Yeah.
His will. Like, it means nothing to him, you know?
Right. Yeah,
his cause
exactly.
or his purpose or whatever his, that's what means anything to him at all.
Must be nice to have so much money that no matter what you know, you can replace anything.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Yeah. Dummy. Love that guy.
Clark Gregg, by the way. I mean, obviously, I'm fond of him even more, having watched him on 7 seasons of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., but I like how they weave him into these early movies enough to make his death in Avengers, like, mean something,
yeah.
you know? Now, this right there, yeah. okay, so if you want to talk about how they were making things up in this universe as they went, I point to that whatever that Captain America shield
yeah.
is. Because it clearly, they just threw that in there. And in fact, it is in the background of a scene in the first movie.
Right.
They were pulling a lot of this stuff together while they were going. Mm-hmm. They're just like, oh, we're going to have Captain America at some point. Let's just throw that shield
mm-hmm.
in. Right? Now, that has no bearing on anything.
So what is it implying that he has it in there half built?
I mean, I take it to mean, in terms of the everything we know about the universe, and we know that Howard Stark has a connection with Captain America, mm-hmm. that now that Captain America's gone and his shield is gone, let's try to build like a mechanized version of that shield.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just like a half-finished mm-hmm. project that Howard Stark never got around to doing.
Yeah.
That's what makes sense to
right.
me.
It is funny, though, using it just as like an extra piece of
yeah, it's a fun... You know what's funny is I was watching this with my daughter. She's 4, yeah. and he's like, "Hey, do you know what that is? I put that there." And she says, she's laughing. He's like, "Doesn't he know that's Captain America's shield?"
That's adorable. That's amazing.
I was like, for her, she's just born into this.
You're right.
This is a Tuesday for her.
You know what's funny? I remember when I think it was your first. Born, I think you had these Marvel cards with all the characters, and you would do this sort
That's
of trick
right.
where you would point at a character and he could name all of them. And it's funny because
right.
at the time I was like, wow, that's amazing. And it's interesting now that I bet more kids than ever could at that moment in time could do that now.
Right. right. See, what you didn't see was all the deleted footage where I kept smacking
when
I got it wrong.
Hawkeye,
like,
come on.
It was my version of Whiplash.
Right, right.
The movie Whiplash, not the villain Whiplash.
Right, right, no.
That movie, by the way, I watched it on your recommendation, and I have PTSD after watching.
Did you watch it recently?
Yeah, just within the last year.
Oh yeah, so good though, isn't it?
It's amazing, and it's like I need time before I watch it.
Oh yeah, I think if I remember correctly, right? the climax of that thing, I like literally jumped out of my chair like, whoo! Oh man. Were you rushing or dragging? Oh yeah, sorry, I don't mean to trigger you.
Yeah.
That's so good though.
It's a great movie.
Yeah.
So anyway, speaking of Whiplash, here's Whiplash over here building his little thing. Yeah.
Shoot. Oh, I had something I was going to say and I totally forgot it. It'll come to me. Salute. Oh, that was a thing, right? The Russian word when he says, I'll make it salute. I guess that's firework, right? That translates to firework.
Oh, yeah. Really?
That was one of those random things I looked up. He's got his cockatoo, so thank goodness for that. So this must be SpaceX here, huh? Also.
Yes. See, I think, you know, that's the failing of Hammer as you know, unlike Tony Stark, like Tony Stark has the goods.
Right.
He's got, he has the ability to follow up on all the sort of the glitz and glamour that he projects.
Right.
Justin Hammer's not a smart guy.
Right.
So he's trying to project that same sense of cockiness, but he has nothing to show for
it.
Like, I think that's something, I mean, I think the films did a pretty good job of really highlighting his, like, supernatural genius. You know, I mean, in Avengers Endgame, he solves time travel.
Right.
By accident, you know.
Oh, I just figured out time travel. Yeah.
Anyway, moving on. You know, it's like.
That's really fun. That's a good point.
It's rather remarkable when you look at, you know, these long-term contracts that Marvel signs with these actors, where you're able to get a whole bunch of appearances.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And it, you know, it fundamentally reshaped franchise filmmaking.
Oh yeah.
Right. I mean, before Marvel, when you think about like a successful franchise was James Bond.
Right.
Right. And that's, well, hopefully if we're lucky, we put out a movie every couple of years. And if we're lucky, we get like five movies with one guy and then, you know, we wash, rinse, repeat.
Right.
And I mean, during the time the MCU has been around, which is, 2008 to now, how many James Bond movies have there been?
Right.
One, two, three.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
The fourth is still TBD.
Should have been four,
this. Yeah, you know?
Wait, so has there ever been a film series where they've introduced a character in a movie and then given that person their own movie, and the way that these movies are all weaved together the way they are?
I mean, not in this way, I don't think.
They wanted to, like, right? Now that I'm thinking of James Bond with that Jinx character with Halle Berry.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think. Like, no, I mean, certainly not at this scale. You know, I'm sure somebody listening to this will be like, oh, well, what about whatever? And it'll be some random thing,
you know?
You know, what about Raj in Van Wilder or something like that?
Right. Well, actually, I mean, touche.
Touche. I mean, I'm sure there are things like that.
Yeah.
But something playing at this level? I don't think so.
Right. And I mean, it's kind of a tall order, though, for something to be as successful where they can continue making them and have like five or more where they can continue to bob and weave back and forth.
And when you think about it, I mean, Marvel is at a point now, right, where, you know, their biggest asset, arguably one of their biggest assets, is this guy right here.
Mm-hmm.
And he's done probably. And yet we're not at a place where we're like, oh, what's Marvel going to do now?
Yeah, right.
Right. Because you look at like they got like four different irons in the fire and you're like, okay, well, no, all of those look like they could go somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a good place to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because otherwise you say, well, what is our option here? Right? Do we bring back Tony Stark from the dead? Is that a story you would want to see?
Right, right.
You know? I mean, that's because in comic books, this is just something that happens. Characters die, they come back. Right. That's just, it's accepted. And yet, I think in the movies, I suspect that for as beloved as Tony Stark is, but we gotta, can't you just hear the music here?
Yeah.
While dancing?
Yeah.
Which is, of course, Jon Favreau used the same song in Swingers.
Mm-hmm. And Sam Rockwell, and then, this is kind of his shtick, right?
His dancing?
Yeah, he did that in Charlie's Angels. And
oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right. Then, but for as beloved as Tony Stark is, I think if there was a Tony Stark comes back to life story, audiences would react.
I agree.
What do you think?
Yeah.
That's like, to me, that's interesting. We respond to the finality of the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what audiences want. Like, it's okay if characters die as long as it's truthful and feels earned.
But they've had the unprecedented good fortune, right, to have built up this enormous, robust universe populated with so many characters that, as we get the Eternals, who we don't really know at this point, we'll get a, you know, Miss Marvel, or what am I trying to say? Captain Marvel movie, right? So we can bring her back. Like, there's certain people we can kind of bring back as we continue introducing new people. And we just, you know, the quilt gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
Right?
It's, you know, like with Chadwick Boseman having passed, right? The question became, well, what happens now with Black Panther, you know? And I think I would imagine that they're struggling with this, because are we able to disconnect the character T'Challa from Chadwick Boseman?
Right, and he certainly would have been one of their anchors carrying forward. Yeah,
That's exactly right. So now do you say, well, do we still have T'Challa even if we don't have Chadwick?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's an open question.
Right.
You know, at some point earlier on in the Marvel universe, if Robert Downey left, would they have recast him? You know.
Drones.
when will we ever learn, Brian?
Yeah.
You know, in the comic books right now, there's a character called Ironheart.
Okay.
Who is she's a teenage girl who figures out her own, like an Iron Man suit.
Mm-hmm.
And so she becomes a character called Ironheart. And she has an AI that is a Tony Stark AI. In her suit.
Sort of like Alfred in Batman Forever or whatever. Or I'm not forever.
I would say more like Jarvis. She has a Jarvis that is Tony Stark.
I mean, like, it's his consciousness, or is it?
It's like a simulation of Tony Stark.
Okay. Like that Miley Cyrus doll in Black Mirror. Do you ever see that?
I haven't seen that, but I'll assume.
Yes. I'll just assume it's a perfect one-to-one analogy.
My point is that that was created in the comic books, and it occurred to me, this is a while ago now, it's probably like 5-6 years, they had to have done that with at least something in the back of their mind that, well, this is a way to keep Robert Downey in the universe if he ever chooses to walk away, because you can just have his voice or whatever.
Sure.
And he can show up to collect his paycheck.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, I feel like that's something that people would probably be okay with, something in that vein.
Sure, sure.
His voice. But that's a way to keep these characters alive even as their stories end.
Right.
So as we are here now, this is Act 3. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what I like first. I like that the stakes are relatively contained.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So we're not in Skybeam territory, which is nice.
Yeah.
The downside is that it's not particularly interesting. in that it's just a lot of explodey, explodey,
yeah,
and a bunch of robots, and I don't really care. I don't know. You tell
me. That's kind of my memory of 3, actually. I wasn't sure if that was this one or 3 when there's all the suits flying around, and it's just kind of hard to keep tabs on what's happening and when we're down and when we're up.
Yep.
Yeah, but you know what? I feel like this was sort of an early complaint with some of these movies, but then they, you know, they take the lessons and then they move forward and get better. So it's just one of the earlier ones where this is just the case.
I like that when you look at the entirety of the first phase, each of the films has stakes that are challenging for the character, but small enough that you believe that they could handle it. Thus, by the time we get to the Avengers, you're like, okay, this is too big for just one person.
Right. Yeah, that's good. That's a really good point.
You know?
Yeah. This is
here's where she finally reveals her Black Widow-ness.
All those lines on their faces, you know, from the lighting. That reminds me of being back in film school where it was like, if you want to make something interesting, you'd make fake blinds and put like a light behind it. So it's like, it's like blind shadow on their face.
Because it's like they're improving.
Yeah, exactly.
it represents the state of their soul. Yeah. They feel trapped.
Surely everyone will see this.
Now, Scarlett Johansson got like $20 million for the first Avengers or something.
Yo, really?
Yeah, but I'm curious what she got for this one.
I wonder. If there is sort of a, yeah, we'll pay you this for the first one, and if it takes, you know, this is sort of a down payment, you know, like an investment in your future with the franchise or something.
Yeah, so it says here she got $400,000 for Iron Man 2.
Wow. Wow. Then to $20 million.
Well, so it says here she got 15 for Black Widow.
Okay.
So maybe she got $20 million for she got $20 million for Black Widow.
Okay.
Starring and producing Black Widow. What did she get for Avengers? I'm curious.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I just saw an article yesterday. I think Cable Guy turned 25 or something. And that was when Jim Carrey got $20 million. And
that's
was
right.
Like unheard of.
It was unheard of.
And then it sort of set a benchmark for other actors. Like, well, shoot. Like, all right. I mean, Jim Carrey got it.
Yeah. By the way, coming up here, we got, there's the first on-screen appearance of MCU Peter Parker.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is, this was one of those, it was like a fan theory that Kevin Feige has tacitly confirmed. And the math seems to work,
I like that.
You know? Because this is, you figure about 5 years from this point, he becomes Spider-Man, and he's about 15 as Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. And this is in New York, so it works.
I love that. That's great.
So do any of these highways and byways look familiar to you?
Not necessarily. I recognize the two things from New York. What are the UFO things from Men in Black?
Right.
I forgot what the World's Fair Center or whatever that is.
Yeah, the world fair, yeah. Right? Yeah, I mean, the amount of money these actors make is just absolutely bananas.
I remember that was a thing with Terminator 3, where Arnold Schwarzenegger went to James Cameron because Cameron wasn't going to be involved. And he's like, should I do it? I don't know. Like, can I do this without you? And Cameron's like, go for it. Just ask for something insane.
And they gave him like a plane.
Right? Well, they gave him $30 million. And it could be something else also. I don't know. But I remember he asked for 30 and they're like, okay.
Yeah, in the mid to late 90s, yeah, we had Jim Carrey.
Yeah.
Well, I think not only was he the first to break 20 million, I mean, he did it so quickly.
Well, and he also had that insane year, I think it was 94, right, where he had Ace Ventura, where he probably got paid peanuts. Then he had The Mask. And then I think...
And Dumb and Dumber.
Dumb and Dumber, right. And so Dumb and Dumber, he ended up getting 7 million because his success had happened so quickly, and he was able to lock that in. So, I mean, he just had a meteoric sort of.
So did Natasha, in addition to putting on her spandex thing there, did she also do her hair in the car?
Like crimp her hair or whatever it is?
Yeah. Hilarious. Because here's the thing. I look at that. Now, at this point, my hair has gotten very long.
Yeah.
And I can't even like type an article on my computer without having to brush my hair out of my face. So the idea that your hair is going to be all like that while she's just like doing scissor kicks on people and stuff.
Yeah.
That's like the most unbelievable part of all of this for me.
But it looks cool. Looks good.
Everything else I buy, but Scarlett Johansson's hair in this specific fight sequence, it ruins the movie for me, Brian.
Yeah, let's just end it here.
Just forget it.
You know what? I've always loved...
And the universe.
Sorry. I'm now thinking about her fighting. I've always loved her physicality, because sometimes what they would try to do with these characters, you know, particularly female characters who are much smaller than the huge hulking people they're beating up, it's like, just accept that this punch from this, you know, person who weighs 100 pounds is going to knock this 300 pound person over, you know?
Right.
And like with her, they're like, no, man, like she just like takes you down. Like she whips, like we're looking at literally right now, like she whips around and uses her legs and gets their necks and spins around them. And you're like, damn, like I'm watching it happen. I believe she took that guy down. You know, I thought they always really nailed that with her.
And obviously the contrast with Happy just fighting dirty, everything. This is one guy.
Right. I got him.
I love that Jon Favreau just has this character for himself in this universe.
Yeah. He can always come back.
That's beloved in his own way. He's just as beloved as these other characters.
Yeah. Jon Favreau, interesting guy, right? I mean, you know, he does Swingers, which he wanted to direct, but they wouldn't let him, right? So they got, his name?
Doug Liman.
Liman, yeah. And so then eventually he makes Maid, which is, I bet a ton of people still haven't seen Maid or even know Maid exists, right?
It's really good.
And then he becomes this, like, big franchise guy, right? Zathura first. Yep. And then now everybody kind of knows him as an actor. He makes Chef just because, you know?
Just
like he's,
cause,
you know, like, where he's still acting and directing and. He's just he's all over the place, but in really interesting ways that people are jealous of other filmmakers or, you know, actor filmmakers.
Yeah. Well, he's able to bounce back and forth really seamlessly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Between, you know, the personal stuff and even like, I mean, like Cowboys and Aliens didn't do that well, but I don't feel like he shouldered the blame for that.
Right. Know? Yeah. Yeah.
He pretty much got away scot-free.
That is I wonder how that happens. That was such a disappointment because I was like, Cowboys and Aliens, like case closed. Like, yeah, that's so genius. Like, let's see people with no technology having to square off against something we understand.
Han Solo and James Bond against aliens.
Yeah. But in the West, with six shooters. Yeah. I mean, it's to me, I don't know how that doesn't work. But if you need to find out how, you can go on Amazon Prime and go find Cowboys versus Aliens.
Harrison Ford, by the way, he was, I think after Jim Carrey, he benefited because he got $20 million for Air Force One, Six Days, Seven Nights. He banked a lot of $20 million checks for movies that maybe didn't really deserve that much.
A lot of plane fuel.
On him.
Yeah. Why not? Right. Was it Hollywood Homicide?
The Devil's Zone, that was one.
Yeah.
Hollywood Homicide. Oh,
dude, you want
God,
to put this all together? Yeah. So when I first moved out here, I went to my very first test screening, which was a movie that no one remembers called The Big, Big Empty, maybe? And it starred Jon Favreau. And I knew they were screening Hollywood Homicide next door. And I knew that had Harrison Ford in it. And I wanted to see that instead.
Oh, wow.
And it's funny because then that came out and was like a huge disaster. And I thought about, well, I wonder what that room was like. But anyway, Harrison Ford, Jon Favreau.
How was The Big Empty?
I barely remember it. It was one of those movies that kind of wanted to be like sort of quirky. And my memory is there's like a little of a sci-fi slant to it that I don't recall right now.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah,
I'm looking it up. Joey Lauren Adams was in that.
Yeah. And the girl from She's All that I'm blanking.
Not Rachel Lee Cole.
Yeah. No, her, right?
Oh, her. Okay.
Yeah. I'm fairly certain.
Apparently she wasn't all that, if you don't remember her name.
Anyway, sorry. All right, back on the screen.
So, you know, this script was written by Justin
Theroux. Oh, I was going to bring that up. Yeah.
Which, that's not a name you affiliate with these films. It's kind of interesting just to see him in here.
Well, I think of him as handsome actor guy Justin Theroux, right?
Hey, right. Mosquito Coast.
Right, right, right.
The television series.
I mean, yeah, sure. And, I mean, tons of stuff.
And he's in The Last Jedi.
That's right. He's like, yeah, the guy with the flower.
The carnation. Yeah.
But he's written a bunch of stuff. I mean, Tropic Thunder and Rock of Ages, which I found shocking, and Zoolander 2.
So one presumes that RDJ brought him in for Iron Man 2.
Sure.
Based off of Tropic Thunder.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, right.
And he's actually talked about his experience making this. He talked about how, like, when he was talking to Kevin Feige, and Feige's like, yeah, we're trying to build up to the Avengers, and Theroux's really like, it's never going to work, I tell you. Mark my words. No one will watch these so-called Avengers, you know.
That's funny.
He was historically wrong there.
Is that true? He
he said it. He's like, yeah, I was like, I don't think it'll work. There's no way. And obviously I was wrong.
Right. You know? Oh, wow. Huh.
But I mean, to his credit, I think most people had at least one arched eyebrow when viewing those plans.
Oh, you know? Sure.
We're going to, like, I think what it comes down to is, especially at this point when you've not had a Thor and Captain America yet, the idea of Iron Man existing alongside those characters. Mm-hmm.
Right.
I mean, think.
Right.
Think about it. At the end of The Incredible Hulk in 2008, we have Tony Stark show up. And that by itself was sort of incongruous.
Right.
Given the world that existed in the first Iron Man film and the world that The Incredible Hulk established, it took a little bit of work to believe that these characters could coexist.
Right.
Right. Again, now we're just like, oh, yeah.
Take it all for granted. But I remember these discussions. Yeah.
I mean, even, you know, at the end of The Incredible Hulk, when Tony Stark shows up, which, by the way, that scene would now have, you know, that would come after the end credits. But they hadn't fully gotten into the end credit swing yet. So that's before the credits.
Right.
But we have Tony Stark talking to General Ross, William Hurt, and he's like, what if I told you we're putting a team together? And you watch it, you're like, wow, what does that mean? Well, when you watch that in sequence with everything else, you're like, that makes no sense in the universe. Yeah. Like, that's right. And they came up with like one of these short films starring Clark Gregg to like explain away the continuity of what Tony Stark is talking about.
Was that the sole purpose of that one short?
Literally to explain
that is hilarious. Yeah.
Because I think the original plan was that after Nick Fury is like, hey, we want you to join the team, then we have Tony Stark saying, all right, let's, you know, put the team together. Mm-hmm. And then they later decided, no, we're going to do something different.
Yeah. Wait, do you remember how they explained it away?
So my recollection is this. They create a situation where it's Agent Coulson is talking to Sitwell, who's like, he turns out to be a Hydra agent. Later on, he's the bald guy with the glasses. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about? He's in the Winter Soldier.
Yeah, I can picture.
And he's like, Thunderbolt Ross wants the Abomination to be on this team that you're putting together. So the Tim Roth character from The Incredible Hulk. And so what S.H.I.E.L.D. does, they don't want that. So they have Tony Stark designated a consultant, and they're basically like, we'll have Tony Stark say he wants the Abomination on the team, and then Thunderbolt Ross won't want that because he doesn't want to do anything that Tony Stark does. And it's like very elaborate, like super nerd inside baseball.
And this is the whole short.
It's these two guys talking, and then they intersperse like the actual footage from the end of The Incredible Hulk.
You know the expression like FU money? Like the fact that they have the resources to be like, oh, Jesus, stupid thing we got to. All right, we'll get like a whole crew, some catering, some like stages, and let's fix it. Like, you know,
Now, real quick, what we just saw there, where we have like the beeping thing that's making the noise and it starts beeping faster. Yeah. Has Pepper not seen enough movies to know? That's not good.
Right, right. That's hilarious.
But yeah, F you money. That's exactly yeah. right. Because they did at least a few of those little shorts with Agent Coulson.
I do remember that. And they would be on the DVDs or Blu-rays. Mm-hmm.
And they were literally just like little continuity band-aids.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, I didn't realize they were all sort of like little fixes. I thought they were just...
Yeah.
To me, I was like, oh, bonus content. That's nice. That's hilarious.
Yeah, it might even be on YouTube. I think it's called The Consultant. That's the one I'm talking about.
You know what's funny when you say...
These two really
Pepper...
do bicker a lot, don't they? These two really bicker a
lot. Yeah. I was going to say, you're saying, hasn't Pepper seen enough movies to know about the beeping? And, you know, when you find out several movies later, right, that Gwyneth Paltrow doesn't even know she's in a Spider-Man movie. Like, I don't know so that she funny. Has. Like,
yeah, I didn't, like, she, like, didn't even recognize Tom Holland. Like, there was something.
Yeah, I think she just reports for duty and goes back to Goop headquarters.
I mean, the Goop stuff notwithstanding, because that's, like, just kind of a basket of crazy. But if you're in these movies, you know, you're getting paid to stand in front of a blue wall and say some stuff. And, you know, would you care what the movie is?
Well, I personally would, but I don't blame her for not caring.
Oh, yeah, fair enough. I personally have a great deal of affinity for all the projects.
Of course. I just mean because I like these movies. But yeah.
Because she's in Spider-Man Homecoming. For like a minute at the end.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, frankly, you could forgive her for being like, wait, what now? I'm with the people
yeah,
I recognize.
She's like, oh, that was Spider-Man?
I don't know what movie this is. Yeah.
Because in the scene she's in, Tom Holland isn't in it. Or rather, like Holland has left, right? So they probably shot her bit when he wasn't around.
Right.
So it's her with Favreau and Downey. Right, she probably thinks it's another Iron Man or Avengers or whatever.
Or some pickup from some movie that she already did or, yeah.
Exactly. So this stuff here is what is setting up the Avengers, right? So the complaint about, oh, all this is just place setting for the Avengers, it's overblown.
Right.
Because we got like 2 minutes in the middle and then this stuff at the end.
Sure, sure.
Now, if you look at the, oh shoot, I meant to point it out when it was there, we might see it again, but you have the various screens around him and there's a scene showing a whole bunch of destruction like in a park, and that's actually it's showing the aftermath of the middle act of the Incredible
Hulk. Really?
So that helps us situate where this movie takes place. Which basically, like, Marvel even put out a timeline which basically says that the Incredible Hulk, Iron Man 2, and Thor all take place within 1 week.
Oh wow.
Yeah, like I think on the official chronology, it's Fury's big week. It's literally like day one, this from Iron Man 2. Day two, this from The Incredible Hulk. Like,
that's funny.
Yeah, you can. I meant to point out, you can see like ambulances and stuff. And that's,
I saw it.
That's the aftermath of The Incredible Hulk. There's also little Easter eggs in the map behind there. You can see, Fury's. There's like Wakanda.
Oh, really?
In there.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Just stuff that, and it's, you know, I mean, a lot of the stuff they hadn't figured out.
Yeah. Right?
Like in the novelization of this movie, like they don't name what the new element is that Stark created to put in the arc reactor. In the novel, it's vibranium. Right. And obviously we know, well, you know, vibranium already exists, but you can buy it as part of Howard Stark's research.
Yeah, sure.
Right? Think about it, right? Because in Captain America, he has the shield, right? And he says, that's all we have. That's all of the vibranium we have is Captain America's shield. That's what Howard Stark says. So it makes sense that after Captain America is presumed dead, the shield is gone, of course he would try to synthesize vibranium. Mm-hmm. So it makes sense that Tony Stark's arc reactor is powered by synthetic vibranium.
Right. Gary Shanley.
What a
singular
genius he was.
Sort of, yeah.
Just like in even a small role, he was memorable. Yep. He was deemed memorable enough to come back for an equally small thing later on. Mm-hmm. So Iron Man 2, what do you think?
I enjoyed it, and I definitely enjoyed it in a way that was impossible in 2010. So in 2010, I'm sure I enjoyed it enough, but probably didn't like it as much as Iron Man 1, right? But again, like revisiting Age of Ultron when we did this, another movie that I was like, yeah, I remember thinking it was just fine. But now that I can sort of put all these chapters together in my mind and what they eventually lead to, I enjoy them in a whole different way. So I really enjoyed revisiting this.
You know, one thing that I said at the time, I remember watching it and I remember liking it well enough. I definitely remember liking the first one more, but what I said was it felt like an issue of the comic. Mm-hmm,
exactly.
Right. And it's the same thing I said about Age of Ultron. It feels like, you know, you get those big crossover stories that are like six parts and then you have like the issues in between. Mm-hmm. And that's what this is to me. Like, well, we don't really care about Whiplash. But you know, we're going to get a little bit of character stuff that's meaningful for Tony Stark. And then, you know, we're sort of biding our time until the big story starts.
Yeah. Which is, I think, more difficult to understand in 2010, right? But now that we have this whole collection on a shelf, we can appreciate it as that and be like, oh, this is the one I haven't seen in a while. Let's revisit it and you will enjoy it.
I think that's definitely apt, right? I think, you know, knowing big picture where everything ends up, you're able to, and I think the filmmakers did a good job of making even the quote unquote unimportant chapters have little bits and pieces that pay off. So like I was saying earlier, I mean, this thing, ultimately, I don't think we end up caring that much about the Ivan Vanko thing, but Tony's relationship with his father ends up being meaningful all throughout.
Right.
I think obviously Jim Rhodes becoming War Machine, that's kind of a big thing, you know, and obviously we get Natasha introduced, right? So there's enough pieces here where, yeah, if you do the marathon, it gives you the pieces that you want.
Do we not see Natasha again till Avengers?
That's right. Yeah, we get because the following year we got Thor and with Captain America, the first Avenger. Mm-hmm. And then 2 years later came the Avengers.
That's another one I need to revisit is Captain America.
Well, as it happens, that film celebrates its 10th anniversary this year.
Stop.
So I would not be surprised. If
great. Perfect.
Well, and you know, I think I mentioned this when we recorded The Rocketeer. This is sort of a Joe Johnston summer for us. Because the Jurassic Park 3 celebrates its 20th anniversary this summer as well. So he has these like at 10 year intervals.
Yeah, you're right.
Right. But I mean, I think that to me is, it was what makes a movie like this. It's a little bit like, you know, when you watch a show like Breaking Bad, right? There's like a handful of episodes that you probably remember by name.
Yep.
Yeah. Right. But you don't regret watching any of the episodes.
No. Yes. If they're rerunning on AMC, it doesn't matter which one it is. I'll enjoy it because it's a slice of a big story that I now know and enjoy.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you like the one where they're stuck in the van.
Mm-hmm.
And there's like dealing with the fly, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Or the underground. Yeah.
Right. It's a bottle show. That you could write that off as a quote unquote filler show, but it's not really
right.
You know, because
it's time with the characters
That's exactly. You're like, yeah, but I like the relationship and it's interesting and maybe it's not advancing like the big story, but it's taking us deeper into our relationship with them and that's going to make the big story work better. And that's kind of this.
Yeah.
You know, the stakes are a little smaller. It's like one of those issues that you read in between the big stories.
Now, I remember these were like in phases, right? Phase one, phase two, whatever. Yeah. So now that Endgame has happened and they go into the next movies, is this just like phase five or something? Or is this like chapter two, phase one?
I think I think they're calling whatever is next phase four.
Okay.
So at this point, like, everything that's been announced is phase four.
Okay.
So the question then is, are we building up to something? Mm-hmm. And I mean, we're not going to know for a while, because when you think about it, we had no inkling when the Avengers came out that this all was going to culminate in the Thanos story.
Right.
You know, even though the Avengers ended with the Thanos tease, for all we knew, that was just setting up the next Avengers movie.
Right.
So what's the next phase, or what's the next series of phases? Who knows? Mm-hmm. That's a good question. I like not knowing, to be honest.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, so when did this whole end credit thing start then? You're saying that they didn't quite have this from the beginning. I mean, is this thing that's coming up here now?
It was in Iron Man. It was in the first
Iron Man. Right, where Samuel Jackson is in his place.
Right. And that was like a total last minute thing, by the way.
Mm.
That was not something that they went into the movie like, okay, we're going to have this at the end. That was like a movie's done, and they're like, hey, why don't we just like throw this in at the end? And, you know, and they just got Sam Jackson in for an afternoon and kept it completely secret. Mm-hmm. And obviously when you think about it, like, had Iron Man not done well, that tease would have been like, oh, that's a shame. Like,
yeah, it's like shoot for the moon, because we don't know.
Right. But when you think about it also, that tease at the end did nothing to make the rest of that movie any less engaging. Mm-hmm. You know, it was not essential.
Right.
I think that's where some of these other movies fall apart that are trying to start their own universe, because they just get ahead of themselves.
Like Masters of the Universe, Skeletor saying, like, I'll be back.
Skeletor at the end.
Just because you've been bringing that up a lot lately.
That, you know, look, next year is the 35th anniversary of that movie. And if you don't think I'm going to drag you by your earlobe.
I don't know if I've ever seen it all the way through.
Well, it's about to happen.
I'm into it. I loved He-Man when I was a kid. All right.
Now this here... this was shot by Favreau and company. This is not shot by Kenneth Branagh.
Okay.
However, they framed it, because the aspect ratio is different. They framed it to be reflective of what we see in Thor. But it was shot by Favreau, and I don't believe what we just saw, that exact footage, makes it into Thor. So it is something completely unique.
Yeah.
And I should mention, I remember watching this movie in the theater with my brother, and he had no idea, you know, what was coming, but he's like, hey, what's this? What's going on? I'm like, just watch, you know. And then as soon as you see the hammer, which is about as iconic a thing as it gets, I just remember him grabbing my forearm and squeezing, like, oh my God. You know? And that's the fun of those end credit scenes, especially in those early, like, cause Captain America, I don't know if you remember this, Captain America ends with a post credit scene. That is the first trailer for Avengers.
Oh, I don't remember.
It's a little mini, you know, whatever, 45-second thing. So it's not just a scene. It's a whole, hey, here's what's coming next year. And oh boy, it's impossible to sum up what it felt like knowing this thing was coming that existed only in my imagination since I was a little kid.
Yeah. You know? I mean, watching this movie, repeating myself is the best way I can put it, is in seeing Thor's hammer there, where I probably would have had to lean over and be like, wait, I recognize that. And you'd be like, Thor's hammer. I'd be like, oh. Wow, neat. But like okay. Now, yeah. And like now watching it, and I'm as familiar with it as you were at that time, you know, right. I'm like, oh, hey, that's fun. You know? Yeah.
Well, I think what you just said is a great way to leave this commentary.
Yeah.
That's fun.
That'd be like our little production card thing at the end of our TV show. It's like some picture of us with our arms around each other. Just like, that's fun.
We got to do that now. That needs to exist. Well, let's put a pin in this. And of course, we will be back soon with our next regular episode, including our thoughts on Black Widow, which will be out by the time folks are listening to this episode.
Wow. Yeah.
So lots of movie film stuff coming up as we move forward through July. So, Brian, anything else you want to hype up before we let you go?
Yeah, we got Puppy Dog Pals dropping. We got to drop in here. We got to drop in there. It's Disney Plus, Disney Junior.
There we go. And the season that is currently airing is what season?
I believe it's 4.
Okay, so new episodes are airing through the summer, or how does...
they drop on Fridays on Disney Channel and Disney Junior.
There you go. All right. As for me, you can find me at the San Francisco Chronicle and IGN, where movie reviews and other feature articles go up regularly. If you are looking to find me online, you can find me on Twitter at Zacky's Corner. That's Z-A-K-I-S Corner. My website, justadda.com. If you're looking to contact us, you can email us at moviefilmpodcast@gmail.com. You can also hit like on our Facebook page, facebook.com/moviefilmpodcast. Please let us know what commentaries you'd like to hear from us. We're always getting recommendations. And as I always say, nothing is off the table. Mm-hmm. We're willing to entertain all of y'all insanity. Because we're nice folk. Because we're good, decent folk here. Here in movie film country.
I like to think so. A nice place.
I think so. I like it. And with that, we'll catch you next time. Thanks, everybody.
David's Bridal, where brides and bridesmaids get fabulously dressed. We let our friends pick out what we wear, show off our dance moves, obsess over every little detail, hold your hand through it all, smile bravely when it's time to let go. Make your dreams come true. The things we do for love, only at David's Bridal.
When you wake up well-rested on a great mattress, everything becomes clear.
I do have a favorite child.
Things you missed when you were tired finally reveal themselves.
I use memes as a coping mechanism.
It's Mattress Firm's once-a-year sale and clearance. Get up to 60% off select Sealy, plus a free adjustable base, all with free and fast delivery. Deals this big won't last long, so don't miss out. The right mattress matters. We'll find yours. Restrictions apply. See store or website for details.